Welcome to the Lync 2013 Ignite Lync Updates and Programs. Today we'll be talking about the configuring Lync Room system in this course. My name is Aaron Steele. I'm joined by Brian Ricks.
Hello, everyone.
So I'm Aaron Steele. I'm a senior consultant. I've been focused on Microsoft Lync here with Microsoft in our consulting services organization for about the past 3 years. I've been doing computers for about the past 18 or so. I live in Chicago with my wife and two children.
And I'm Brian Ricks. I am an independent consultant, owner of Brightcom Computers. I do stuff that has to do with Microsoft, typically infrastructure related, very UC heavy in the past 5 or so years. So as such a unified communications architect, and I am an MVP, have been since 2006. Been using Lync and its predecessor since LCS 2003, and have my MCSM certification in communications. I've been doing this for about 20 years and been independent since around 2009.
Great. So setting some expectations, really the audience for this is IT and telecommunications professionals who design, plan, deploy, and maintain solutions for unified communications. And we do expect you to have some experience in Lync and its sort of its brethren. And really what you're trying to learn here is the updates we've introduced since 2013 when RTM. We have some resources here for you to go and get sort of educated on Lync 2013. We have the 336 and 337 set of educations. And to pair with those, we have exams that sort of prove that that learning has taken place. And you can contract and work with one of our certified learning partners and sort of find a class for you to take if you want to go down that course.
Go down the course.
Go down. Course. This okay. Course here, as we said, is going to be talking about configuring the Lync Room system. We're going to talk about we're going to have a little video to sort of introduce that topic and about everyone, video for everyone in the enterprise. We're going to introduce you to what Lync Room system is. We're going to talk about a few of the partners and what they have available. Then we're going to get into the configuring capabilities, how you schedule meetings and sort of what some of the intricacies are when you schedule meetings for a Lync Room system, what capabilities you have for managing that room system, what we mean when we say migration and coexistence and how you do that, what capabilities it has for resiliency and failover, what the remote admin portals look like from some of the different vendors, and then finally, how this integrates into System Center and the operations framework. So when we talk about video for everyone in the enterprise in Lync Room System, we're getting back to this idea that we're shooting for everybody has some capability to do video in the enterprise or in the enterprise to do video. It comes in a different set of sort of flavors and capabilities when you're talking from interoperability through a third-party gateway or interoperability built into Lync where we're talking to systems that aren't Lync, third-party MCUs, Lync across platforms, and then we get this best of all the worlds in a Lync Room system experience where it really is the Lync codec, right? We're really looking to... It is a Lync client. It is the Lync Room system is just another Lync endpoint, but with some enhanced video and collaboration capabilities.
Now, the focus of video shifted then dynamically from 2010, which was more of a voice-centric kind of thing and development approach, whereas 2013 in video is really what we've been looking at.
Most definitely. It was really the focus of the product group when we were shooting for how they were building 2013 and what they were focused on. A lot of it had to do with video and the proliferation of video, not just at the devices, but in the boardrooms and conference rooms. So when we talk about meetings and migration or meetings between 2010 and 2013, what we recognized as some of the key meeting issues was that remote users were second-class citizens, right? They were they didn't have video as sort of a first-class environment. When they were appearing, they were these small little tiles of video. That they had, just challenges when you're remote. We recognized that meetings were productivity islands, right? That is, you would jump from meeting to meeting and accomplish things, but you didn't have the continuity of space and continuity of use across it. Setup and startup were too difficult and take too long. Meeting joins when you're in these large meeting rooms simply takes too long or took too long. And it was a challenge participating from the web or from mobile endpoints.
Yeah, whenever you have in a conference room a book, and then by book, multiple pages telling you how to get your laptop that you've brought into the conference solution that you're going to go join in there, that's never a good thing.
No, no. Anytime there's instructions printed out that the users have to follow to dial in or click to join or do any sort of interaction to start that call, it's never a good thing. So in Lync 2013, we had a few goals. We wanted to innovate in video-based collaboration. We wanted to really think to the future about what was the next goal and what we were shooting for. We wanted to make meetings more productive using Office. So we had this idea to integrate OneNote and make that integration a more seamless and a more helpful experience for the end user. We wanted to modernize the meeting experience, aligning with the new look and feel of the tablets, of the phones, and so on. We really did shoot for extending the meeting reach. That is, we wanted to give you the capability to join that meeting from your web, from your mobile, join from VDI, et cetera. Essentially, we wanted to solve the meeting room problem, right? Make it so that meeting rooms, when they are there, can be best utilized, and when meeting rooms aren't there, or when it's some users in the meeting room and some users outside the meeting room, we can get a best world experience. The challenges, really, from that conference room experience really are, how long does it take to start a meeting? We've seen sort of in our internal case studies that the average time to start a meeting was over 8 minutes. We had some people whose meetings took 22 minutes to start when they were collaborating with other parties.
That's not good when you have a 30-minute meeting.
No, it's really
22
not.
22 of it's just trying to get it to go.
One of the other challenges was, is video part of that conference room? We have so many conference rooms where the room isn't enabled for video yet, and a lot of popular projectors don't work well when we're trying to also present in a live meeting, where we're trying to share content in a live meeting. Maybe we're trying to present something also to the people in the room and collaborate across both those media.
Mm-hmm.
And what about collaboration? Again, can you present a PowerPoint or share your desktop while shooting video? What's the interaction? Do the people in the room get a sense of the people outside of the room? How well are they brought into the meeting? What about interactive whiteboarding? We have this challenge about, can you be both presenting a PowerPoint and allowing for whiteboarding in your meeting? And then lastly, is telepresence the right solution for all organizations? Telepresence is this idea of these dedicated meeting rooms with large amounts of reserved bandwidth and connection to other dedicated high expense meeting rooms. Really, what we found is that a telepresence room is a $300,000 initial setup cost, and then annual maintenance costs for that network and for those bandwidth things.
And that's $300,000 per room. You need at least two.
Yes.
Right? So, yeah. Okay.
And those solutions really get marketed at executives, not information workers, right? So if you're deploying a $300,000 conference room, you may not deploy that out such that all your information workers can book that room at any time for their little one-on-one meetings.
Yeah, and for executives, this $300,000 room meant executives that had money to spend $600,000 minimally. And then, you know, and there's business case for it if that made sense at the time. But this room system solves the other 95% of the user population.
Yep. So we get to this idea of the Lync room system. And we're going to talk about what this room system is. But the truth is, a room system isn't a system you build. It is a system you buy from a vendor. But it's not the traditional telepresence system where you're buying the furniture to go along with the system.
There's also no additional gateways, pieces of hardware, projectors, right. All that kind of stuff.
It is just another Lync client. Lync is the one and only Lync system. There is one Lync system. This room system is signing in as a Lync-enabled account. It is performing Lync functions. It is working with the same conferencing protocols and the same procedures. Think of it as a Lync desktop,
right?
Just with a really big monitor.
We get all the feature parity, everything. It gets full functionality and is a first-class citizen.
Most definitely. So when we talk about the benefits of this, it's really back to it is Lync, right? It isn't some third-party product that you're integrating and forcing in and shoehorning in to be part of this system. It's easy to use. It gives your users that sense of comfort and familiarity from their familiar Lync user interface. You can start and join meetings with that single click. Meetings are easy and intuitive to manage. There's always on in some of these with special hardware, so you get this this management of this system that's always there, always ready, always able to be simply and quickly joined into these meetings.
Right. Well, and we'll see, it really is click to join.
It connects people because it allows those remote participants to both see and hear the people in the conference room that's been set up with this, and you no longer have this disparate sort of setup where people have to go to this conference room and they can talk to other people in another one of these conference rooms, but the only interaction that remote participants see is audio because they're dialed into a bridge. And it's really, the really last piece of this is it's easy to deploy. Comprehensive solution sold by a number of partners, simple provisioning in the same way you would provision any other Lync account. There's no transcoders or gateways required, and you can manage it through the same sort of Lync IT policies and same things you can manage other Windows-based systems in your environment with. And the truth is, if you can use a Lync room system, you can use Lync. Or the other way around, if you can use Lync, you can use a Lync room system. We've got a little video here about the Lync room system.
Lync room system provides an immersive meeting experience in a real room setting. With Lync room system, you can join a Lync meeting with one touch and collaborate with remote participants in just seconds. And because it's Lync, you can collaborate using familiar Lync features, such as the whiteboard and desktop sharing. With high-definition video and touch-enabled displays, your Lync meeting is truly a face-to-face experience. The console lets you manage most of the meeting and room features. The views and options vary depending on your Lync room system configuration. Tap a participant's name to open a menu that gives you options that include unmute, mute, and remove. The icons next to each participant's name show their meeting activities, such as video sharing, desktop sharing, or instant messaging. If you want to invite someone else to join the meeting, tap Invite More People and search for their name. Tap it to add it to the list, and then tap OK. Tap Display to choose a view for the room monitors. For example, you can show only the meeting participants, or participants and content. The display setting applies only to the room monitors. It doesn't affect the on-screen view for remote Lync meeting participants. To send an instant message to everyone, tap IM, tap the text input area, and then type your message. Everyone in the meeting room and online can see instant messages. An asterisk means a new message has been posted. The toolbar at the bottom lets you control devices and the whiteboard. When your meeting is over, just tap Leave Meeting. Your meeting won't actually end until the last participant leaves the meeting. You can take advantage of this feature to leave and rejoin the meeting as often as you'd like. To learn more, visit lync.com.
So this was a little video showing how easy and simple it is to interact with these Lync room systems. Now the question comes, Where will you find Lync room systems? The idea is, where does Lync room interact with these meetings? We can see it interact in simply conversing in one-to-one. We can see it with producing knowledge. That is, you can use these Lync room systems not just as meeting spaces, but as these places to both to collaborate with those people who are both remote and local. Reporting, status reviewing, right? There's no reason you can't introduce these. We see them fitting really, though, especially well in these 16 person size rooms where it's a conference room, where you've got, you know, 75%. What we've found is, in fact, 75% of those meetings have less than 10 people in them. And then there's this idea of a focus room is another place where these can happen really well, around 100 square feet. And the truth is, what we're finding is an increasing number of meeting spaces are more focus rooms rather than meeting rooms, where they're working areas for groups to come in and collaborate rather than these dedicated meeting spaces with much more formal agendas. From a hardware perspective, what makes up a Lync room system? Really, it is a mix of an appliance, and that's usually a quad-core, you know, Intel processor with a video capture card and an HDMI, you know, content for sharing and connecting to a laptop. It's got a camera with a wide view HD front of room camera. Sometimes next generation HD round tables are involved in these systems. We've got displays ranging from 1080p 55 to 84 inch touchscreens to 1080p 55 to 70 inch dual touchscreens. And we've got little 720p 10 inch consoles for all those rooms.
And that's in the video where we saw them controlling things. That's that little screen.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. And then we've got, from an audio perspective, we are, since we are a first class Lync citizen, we're doing wideband audio with stereo or monaural audio capture or array capture. So we're getting a wide spectrum of audio from the rooms where these are placed.
Yeah, and as an interesting side note, this is the one time when if you are a Lync client joining a Lync room meeting where you can get G722 stereo to a Lync client. Otherwise, we don't. But
yep.
Yeah, that's interesting.
From a software perspective, the first piece is that Lync room system is running on Windows 7 embedded standard. It'll likely get updated to Windows 8 sometime in the near future. It's set up with AppLocker on it, with write filters and a firewall. The idea is this is a purpose-built device that shouldn't be changed or modified and really prevents the end users from accidentally installing additional software on it. They're customized. It's got a little bit of customized Lync client for that meeting room, so it is the Lync client in the background, but it is built on the UCMA API that just like the Lync client was, and it is customized a bit. It is optimized for Lync Server 2013. We do give you a console user experience to manage and facilitate the meeting that might have a little bit of a different look and feel from your standard Lync client, but remember, it is still the Lync client in the background. And honestly, one or two displays is really about the size of the conference room and sort of what the purpose of those meeting rooms are.
That's right. And in those little kind of breakout rooms, that's exactly the idea. You'd have one of these systems sized to the size of the room and then a single camera or an audio system that's built in. I mean, it's different sizes for different shapes of rooms and
most
setups.
Definitely. From a manageability perspective, we really get to this remote admin portal. It's Windows basics for updating and monitoring. System Center provides a management pack for these Lync room systems, and you can join that console to your domain and manage it. There are some caveats and some things to watch out for when you join that console to your domain. We've got a couple of partners that we're working with on this, and it really is about the ability and availability for any of those partners to you to get the piece of hardware that fits your needs best, that works best for your system.
Yeah, this isn't something that I could build with my own black box solution. This is special hardware in that it's delivered from a vendor, but very basic hardware.
Yeah, delivered from a vendor, but customized to provide all these features, and it goes through comprehensive testing processes. So we've got partners from Crestron and Smart and Polycom. Polycom has said to us that they will have a solution for Lync room system by the end or in the second half of 2013. So it is coming. It's just we don't have, as we say, in market, we don't have any systems right now. Today we have in market available, purchasable systems from Crestron and Smart. And for those of you who are interacting with Microsoft and the technology centers, we've actually got Lync room systems deployed in all these locations and in all these Microsoft technology centers around the world. So if you're working with your Microsoft account teams, you can go in and see, test, and play with these Lync room systems for yourself.
Yeah.
It should be noted that Moscow and Sao Paulo are awaiting installation. They've received the hardware, but
it's not quite there yet.
Yeah. We'll talk a little bit now about how you schedule a meeting and what it looks like to invite a Lync room system into an environment. From the meeting invite perspective, it really is as simple as adding a resource to the meeting invite, changing the Lync invite to a Lync meeting, and sending it. Right? There's nothing additional here for me to book out the room, to change it, to make anything else happen. But because I've added that Lync room system as a resource for this meeting, they will get invited, and then the join controls will be there on the Lync Room system when I go in to join that meeting.
And that's significantly different than other solutions that are in the market that have their own scheduling software outside of your existing. I mean, this is how you schedule meetings anyway.
For a lot of companies,
they actually book their rooms this way. So why not just make this room be one that has the LRS system in it?
Most definitely. When we're talking about meeting types and the custom meeting types that we have, LRS supports private meetings. But it should be noted that the subject won't show on that LRS join calendar, on that little console in the room. It will show the time that the meeting is happening, but it won't show the subject if that meeting has been made private. The lobby control option, though, we should be aware of, does need to allow for the LRS to join that meeting. So if you've got closed meetings, you should be aware that those closed meetings must have the LRS as a participant in the meeting. Otherwise, they won't be able to join and might have to be admitted through the lobby. And that is the case for LCS or Lync 2010 and OCS hosted meetings. The LRS won't be a part of that environment and must be joined in through the lobby. A little bit more about those custom meeting types. We're seeing here what the console for some of these rooms looks like. And for those private meetings, you may in fact have to, if the LRS isn't there in that meeting, you may in fact have to authenticate on that tablet and join into the room as yourself in addition to the meeting. And then the other option you've got is the remote participant in the Lync client can admit the room from the lobby.
Yeah, one of the nice things that we don't point out here on the slide, but I like, is that little middle option of room free for 30 minutes reserved. So you can actually do the reverse, come into a room, see that it's free, click the button, and it's yours. It books the calendar out
for you. It's scheduled on the calendar, and you can.
And so you don't have to worry about someone overbooking that 30 minutes. But you can actually, grab a room.
Grab a room right from within the room. It's a really nice little feature. So from an ad hoc perspective, as you were talking, that's that ability to simply walk into a room that's free, start a whiteboard, invite those remote users, potentially connect your laptop and get those VGA or HDMI connections to project as well as share out a PowerPoint. It's really nice for those business guests, and you can turn this on to let remote users in if desired. It's very similar to the Meet Now functionality that you're used to in the Lync client. It's, in fact, a Meet Now button on the Lync Room system console. Once we start talking about managing the Lync Room system, we're getting into a little bit of how those integrate into the Active Directory and what it looks like to create and configure those accounts. When we're talking about what the account is used for, the account is used for both authentication to Active Directory, as well as authentication into Lync, as well as authentication into Exchange, to retrieve the calendar information, as well as potentially send whiteboard contents as attachments to meeting participants at the end of the meeting. So whether you've joined your LRS system to a domain, you will need to have a domain joined account or a domain account that LRS system works with to authenticate to these different services.
Now, that's just an AD account that I call whatever I happen to call. It could be an Exchange account I already have for that particular room that now I want to kind of elevate into an LRS.
Right, but it will require you to Exchange and Lync enable that account to get it connected into these systems. And it can be configured in an Exchange 2010 or 2013 as a resource type account with a password that the system manages. From a provisioning point of view in your on-premise deployment, and it should be noted that as of right now, LRS is on-premise. The idea is you want to identify that conference room, obviously. Determine if it already has an Exchange mailbox. If it doesn't, you need to create a resource mailbox for that user. It has to have a mailbox, otherwise it can't contain the calendar information. Mm-hmm. Set a simple set of mailbox properties, and if necessary, enable the account for login. You may have previously created a service account for this that wasn't enabled for login, that was just a shared mailbox for some reason. Once it's enabled for login in Active Directory, you can enable the account for Lync in that Lync 2013 pool. It really is important to remember here, though, in a coexistence environment, the LRS system must be homed on a Lync 2013 pool. From a creating and configuring those perspective, you can do it through the, you know, through the Exchange console or through PowerShell. It's creating a new resource type mailbox. You give it a first name, a last name. It's best, though, to enable automated calendar processing on these. It makes it so you don't have to have a user managing that calendar for the Lync Room system.
Yeah,
it'll work
all automatic,
seamlessly.
Right.
We want to make sure that we don't modify or that we modify the default behavior in those auto-accepted meetings, that we don't put the sender's name or the organizer's name as added to the subject of the meeting. It puts us in a situation where it sort of complicates the UI of the Lync Room system.
Right, and that's a PowerShell command that you can flip, so it's nothing that you have to do but one time, and then you don't have to worry about it.
Yep. So again, we want to take it, and when those meetings are private, we want to remove the... Rather, we want to prevent the showing of the subject of a private meeting by telling it to remove those private properties on those auto-accepted meetings.
And that's how we get the lack of meeting name on the consoles and things of that nature.
Yep. It's best here to potentially define yourself a mail tip for these Lync Room system-enabled meetings. It just sort of increases the user, you know...
awareness?
Yeah, user awareness and their sort of pleasure with using the rooms.
Yeah, and it's you know, anytime you get a, you know, the one that I have that I demo and that I have that my kids love so much is anytime they try to send me an email on our internal system, they get the pop-up, the mail tip, careful, he's the boss. And so those kind of tips are, to your pleasure point,
yeah,
they're fun. They're makes the system not such a system and more of a user experience, and this is what this tip will do as well.
Yeah. It's the idea of telling your users when they're scheduling that meeting and alerting them that there is a Lync Room system in this room that they're booking. Mm-hmm. Your steps for configuring move down into we walk through all this detail of configuring the account so it can log in. A best practice here, though, is to keep that password such that it never expires from a maintenance perspective.
And that allows you to log into the room system if it is a one that's locked as the room system, assuming you know the account for that room system.
Mm-hmm. So Exchange Web Services, rather, does require authentication, obviously, because we're authenticating to a specific mailbox for that. And that's why we need to enable that username and password.
Mm-hmm.
We get back to this question of, should our LRS system be domain joined? The truth is it can be part of a work group. If you are part of a work group, you require some manual intervention to import your certificates in your trusted routes. But generally, joining it to a domain has some definite benefits. You get much easier and simpler certificate import in most locations. Easier management because you're now assigning Active Directory groups and domain users to administrative rights on these Lync Room systems.
And that's highly important if you're going to be using something like System Center Operation Manager and you want the easiest experience for managing and the most robust experience for managing the system.
Most definitely. So a couple of things to pay attention to, though, when you're joining your LRS to a domain. Make sure you understand what GPOs are in place and in play on the OU where your Lync Room system lives. You may want to create a separate OU if at all possible. Be aware of how block inheritance and no override on those GPOs cause. Just check them.
Right.
Check them to make sure. Also check settings like auto lockout and power management. It'd be really sad if your Lync Room system turned itself off because you were applying a power management policy and people walk into the room and they have to wait for it to boot up. We get back to those 8 to 22 minute join times for meetings.
Yeah, remember, this should be treated as an appliance. It is locked down, it is firewalled, it is secured. So the need for additional hardware or software for monitoring and antivirus, those things all go away.
Yep.
And you just need to treat it as you would any other appliance.
Yep. So in terms of the Lync enabling for this, it's really about enabling the Lync Room system. It is optional to enable this for enterprise voice. It gives it some additional capabilities when you enable it for enterprise voice. It can dial out to end users and join users in without starting a conference bridge.
Yeah, and an interesting point here, or it's something you may notice as you're looking at the slide, is this is a command you probably have never used, enable CS meeting room. That's the special notice to the account that this is an LRS.
Right.
Versus just being a CS-enabled user.
Right, right. This is a different parse of the enable command, but it's enable-cs meeting room, and it really configures it. You'll note, though, that that 2013 command is, or that PowerShell command is only available in 2013. So when you're doing that step, as I say, it's optional to give it a tell URI that can let the system receive calls from the outside world, and if it is enterprise voice enabled, it can allow it to place calls to the outside world and send the correct caller ID. Once we get back to managing it, moving and deleting LRSs really only is happening in PowerShell. There isn't a control panel option to move that room. Move-CS user won't find this room, and it won't be able to move it. So when you're doing pool maintenance, things like that. And if you ever want to disable it, there is no option to disable it through the control panel. You can assign policies, as I say, voice policies to restrict calling, give it dial plans, give it those things, just like you would any other user. And it should be noted with conferencing policies, though, that the organizer of the meeting, their policies apply when the LRS joins the meeting, right? Because it's rare that your LRS is going to be the one organizing the meeting.
Yeah, the only caveat there is as mentioned, that the LRS system itself, because there are user policies to prevent things like your gallery view, we need to make sure it's not restricted. And there are documented best practices for that on how it's recommended to set it up. Obviously, you can do however you want. But
yeah. But the deployment guide has a good set of benchmarks and baselines for what we've found to work best with the Lync Room system. So from an Office 365 environment, this is a little bit different. You can connect it into O365 from a conferencing perspective, but you can't do any of the enterprise voice pieces that you would when you're doing your on-prem deployment.
Because there is no enterprise voice in Office 365 currently.
Exactly. So from a high-level perspective, though, it's very similar to the on-premise deployment of this, but you're doing it through the Exchange Online or Lync Online PowerShells. You're, again, creating and setting that mailbox and the properties necessary for it, the auto-processing, things like that. Then you're connecting to the Lync Online PowerShell, enabling that account and assigning it a license, and then setting password expiry and things like that. When we're walking through this in the remote PowerShell, it's a little bit different. We're walking through how to get that remote session into the Office 365 cloud. We're walking through creating a new mailbox in that cloud environment. We're walking through setting up that calendar processing, which is just the same as setting up calendar processing in your on-premise deployment, right? But we have to create that those same settings to do the same privacy and the same removal of the subject. Same thing to set the mail tip. Then we drop and we have to change sessions because now we have to drop into the Exchange or the Lync Online PowerShell, right? Where now we're having to find that pool name because a pool name is a little different in the O365 tenant environment. And the pool name is going to come back as somepool.infra.link.com. And that's the way you're going to enable those users through that PowerShell. Again, back through the administrative console of your O365 tenant, you need to find this user you've now enabled and assign them to have a Lync Online license for your environment. That's the one sort of little different piece. It isn't this same user doesn't get provisioned through directory sync and all those things.
Right. This user is actually provisioned directly through PowerShell, directly on the system. And if their sync were involved, if that still works, you just have to do it all through PowerShell anyway, so there it goes.
But the truth here is Lync Room system supports your deployment of choice. It supports whether you're running Lync server on-prem, in your cloud, private cloud, dedicated, Lync hybrid. It does support split domain. It does support those server, those users being split between your online and your on-prem environment. And it does support full O365 Lync online and partner-hosted multi-tenant environments.
Right, and the real reason, the simplicity of the reason being, it is a Lync client. It is a Lync user, and so you're just making a mailbox and a Lync account.
Yep. When we talk about what topologies are supported, this is very similar to what topologies are supported from other Lync clients, but with everything on-prem,
everything works.
And as we say, voice is on-prem only. With Office 365, everything online works fine, but there's that via third party. That is, you need a secondary system that connects your system for enterprise voice in some O365 plans. With hybrid, it's important to remember, though, that when you're doing this, if Exchange is online, it's that little matrix of when Lync is online, Exchange can't be on-premise for it to work. And you only get it, and you only get voice if that Lync room system is homed on-prem. So from an LRS online deployment and sort of how this topology works, it's this idea that it's still that same directory sync, those same pieces. And when you're doing an on-premise deployment, it's everything on-premise. And when you're doing an all online deployment, there is no on-premise piece of this. But it's still the same pieces that work, the same SIP, TLS. It's all secure on the wire. It's all built. And it is a Lync client, as we keep saying. From a migration and coexistence point of view, this is where we talk about Lync room systems and earlier versions of Lync. So in a mixed setup, there are some challenges, and we'll talk about that a little later, or right now.
In a few seconds later.
So from a coexistence point of view, really it's only Lync 2013 that's aware of LRS objects. So the Lync 2010 user replicator filters that room system out of its GAL. So sign in, when you need to make this sign in happen, you need to point your SRV record to your 2013 pool or manually configure your LRS to your 2010 pool. But for external access, you need to configure your Edge server to go to your 2013 pool. It's sort of that next hop piece that gets Lync Room System to be able to sign in. So from an interoperability point of view, you'll notice that Lync 2013 or Lync 2010 on this checkmark list, only public meetings. That is, the only time Lync Room System can join a Lync 2010 meeting is if that's a fully anonymous meeting. Everything else doesn't work with Lync 2010.
Right, and it goes back to the previous slide of 2010 doesn't know about the 2013 because it's not in his user roster list, and so he is anonymous. He's a nobody. He's an invalid person as far as he's concerned.
Yep. So an LRS must, in those coexistence scenarios, be homed on a Lync 2013 server. The Lync Room System can join Lync conferences hosted by 2010 users, but when joining those, they get no multi-view and no video lock on those participants. They get no 1080p inbound or outbound. It's simply a limitation of Lync 2010. There's no auto-mute by the Lync 2013 clients if LRS is detected. It's a little thing about that. They can only join conferences that are private, can't join those private meetings. And there is some performance hit on the desktop sharing.
Yeah. I mean, if you think about it, it's no different than if a 2010 client scheduled a meeting and you're a 2013 client in a mixed environment and joined their meeting, you can only get the features of their 2010. It's the MCU that doesn't know and have the functionality.
It only does 720. It only does those other lower audio technologies, things like that. Mm-hmm. From an Exchange perspective, we do support Exchange on-prem and Exchange online. Mailbox access is required for calendars and meeting join. If you don't have a mailbox, though, for some reason, you only get Meet Now and Ad Hoc Conferencing is an interesting thing to remember here.
And it's also important to note that we do support all the way back to Exchange 2007. So 2007, 10, 13 all function properly.
Yep. From a resiliency and failover perspective, we're talking a little bit here about how to improve the availability of your Lync Room system. But again, Lync Room system it benefits from all the back-end improvements of a Lync 2013 client. Remember, it's just a Lync client. So in this, remember that DC01 and DC02 are paired pools. So a user who's homed on one can just as well sign in onto the other one. The head office LRS is homed on DC01. But because of that pool pairing, all content is replicated to pool 2 and vice versa. In case of a pool failure, the administrator performs a pool failure step to manually fail those steps over, and then the LRS will benefit from this failure and work as normal in those situations. It is good to remember that a branch can have a Lync Room system, and it can register to an SBA in those branches and maintain that functionality of the P2P the P2P world in that failover.
Yeah, and it's also good to remember that an SBA is hard-coded to whatever pool he is set as. And
yeah.
So in a pool failure, if DC02 were to fail, he doesn't have anywhere to go.
Most definitely. From a remote administration perspective, this is really an on-premise only, not online thing. Once you've got a Lync Room system, you can administer this via a portal, a web portal on the Lync Room system. It shows basic configuration and health information and the current state of all your rooms. So this is a sort of an IIS kind of function that lets you connect to and see the status of all your Lync Rooms in the environment. Gives you hardware information, versions, network settings, when the last maintenance happened. You can change your credentials, you can modify settings about the volume, whether it be the mic, the speaker, or the ringer. You can trigger updates, so if there are version updates that come from the partners who are building these systems, you can push those out, and you can remotely restart the console and the appliance PCs. This is just a screenshot of what that summary page looks like for somebody's Lync Room system. And we show a bunch of systems, a lot of users, some Lync Room systems. We show they're online. We show if they're in conference or away. When was the last time they refreshed the data? When's the next meeting? What their version of the Lync Room system is? When you click down and get into the detail of what these rooms look like, it starts to show you details about the software and hardware versions, what potential updates they have, what the settings for. We can see over here the speakers, the mic, and the ringers are all set, what they're set to, what the system mode is. So it's a really nice sort of web interface that lets you see a really good, both broad and detailed view of Lync, of these Lync Room systems. The architecture of that it really is a UCMA-built application where an admin comes in through an HTTP call. It's making SIP calls into the Lync Room system. It subscribes to a custom set of categories to get those, what we would traditionally call presence, but for the Lync Room system, more term to the state. And the architecture, just general architecture of this, when it's deployed, does ensure the high availability of it because you can monitor and maintain these things. This is just talking about what the install prerequisites are. It really does require you to have at least the July 2013 update of Lync 2013 on your server. You create a dedicated SIP-enabled account for LRS application and a dedicated SIP account for the LRS support. You create some global Active Directory security groups to contain users who can administer LRS and who those who can support it. And then you install, as I say, an ASP.NET application and Visual Studio Developer Edition. You then configure this as a Lync trusted application through your standard setup, where you would configure a trusted application and the ports necessary for that. Then you run install Lync Room Admin Portal. You modify the web config, right? It's an install routine.
Right. And so what we've created is an app Lync application server like any other application server, which may or may not be able to reuse one you already have if there's something in your environment. But if not, this will be a system. It's key to know it's not running on the pools as the back end. This is something completely off the pool servers in order to manage these rooms.
Yep, through this web admin portal. So when we're integrating Lync Room System into System Center, we're just going to walk very quickly through the management pack and what we get out of the System Center Operations Manager. It's the management pack is just like any other management pack for Lync Room for Operations Manager. It's an additional component built by the Lync team to manage this. It defines a set of information the agents collect and report to the management server. It contains a pre-built set of rules and monitors relevant and monitors the info relevant to Lync Room System health and efficiency. It manages and tracks logs from the Lync Room System, and it can set up notifications through the Operations Manager if certain events occur.
Yeah, one of the nice things about using, well, SCOM in general, is the people that build the packs are the people that built the product, and so therefore they're giving the monitors and alerts that they think are important to the product that they designed. So in general, it's going to be pretty accurate. There may be some tweaks for your environment, but it's a great way to start to get real live data and tracking information and be proactive about the rooms rather than waiting for something negative to happen.
Most definitely. So just in general, we have a little summary here. Lync Room System brings Lync to the meeting room. It's no longer the case where you're walking into the meeting room with your laptop and you now have to share, you know, project and join into a meeting, and you get this sort of disjointed experience where the people who are coming in over the web have a second-class experience and the people who are dialing in just get the voice. Remote attendees aren't left behind. It's really friendly to your IT. I know it's sort of a little strange to say you want to be nice to your IT guy, but
you do.
he's the one who controls your environment, right? You want to be friendly to him, so there isn't that separate infrastructure. It's sold by partners as a basics thing. And we've got a little video here to show what the future of Lync Room System is bringing to us.
Back in the day, we worked the same hours, sitting together in one building. Clock in, clock out. You joined a meeting by walking to it. But the way people work together has changed, fast. And suddenly, with Lync, we're here. And despite all of our amazing progress, a lot of meeting rooms are stuck in the 1950s. Remote teams are an afterthought, and efficient collaboration suffers. Why should room layouts and communication tools dictate how we work? It's time for technology and space to get in sync. Today, Microsoft Lync Room System offers a more intelligent, nimble way. It's always on and ready, so remote teams can instantly join the room without waiting around, and everyone works together in an interactive and immersive environment. We envision a future where we'll go even further, considering every aspect of the meeting experience, room layout, lighting, furniture, and hardware, with intuitive software to tie it all together. People will be able to freely move about the room and easily collaborate, knowing the remote team can hear every word and see every sketch and gesture. And what if we could stage your appearance despite a noisy and an unflattering background, so we always sound and look our best? We also imagine smart spaces for quick group huddles, where spontaneous collaborations become easy, whether down the hall or across time zones. We see an exciting future where working with remote teams is completely natural. Meetings are about ideas. We shouldn't even notice the tools in space. It's the people that matter.
So that was just a little video showing sort of what the future of Lync Room system is coming.
Where it's going, what it could be.
Yep. We've got a couple of references here just for you to learn a little more about Lync Room system and sort of what's out there and what's coming. There's the deployment guide that's out there, how to manage PowerShell or how to manage Lync Online through your PowerShell and where Exchange Online through PowerShell is. So we've got the Lync conference coming up here in 2014 in Las Vegas.
Yay, Las Vegas!
February 18th to the 20th at the
Aries.
At the Aries Hotel in Las Vegas. You can register at linkconf.com. We think seats are filling up pretty quick, so we'd encourage you to register. We thank you for joining us for the Lync 2013 Ignite, Lync updates and programs about the Lync Room system.
Thank you.